Yeah, go for it.
Okay, good evening everyone, and welcome to the fourth in the Landscape Urbanism lecture series here at the AA. The fourth and final lecture presented this evening by Dr. Jon Goodbun, titled Dialectical Ecologies, Architecture and Politics in the Age of Capitalist Crisis. Jon Goodbun completed his PhD thesis, which is called The Architecture of the Extended Mind Towards a Critical Urban Ecology, in the summer of 2011. And this has also been recently shortlisted for a REBA award and is to be published by Ashgate sometime early in 2013, which will be great because it will mean everyone will be able to get to read that. I've read the original PhD thesis and fascinating it is. As well as working on that, he has written, as I'm sure many of you will know, written widely on architecture, urbanism, and related issues, perhaps most recently including co-guest editing an AD special edition on scarcity. He also teaches at Westminster University, and he's a member there too of the Institute for Modern and Contemporary Culture. He teaches as well at the Royal College of Art and at the Bartlett UCL, and has as well a new position as a visiting professor starting in 2014 at Carleton University in Canada. You can also, if you look up the kind of bio blurb on the AA's website, you will be able to see in turn John's own design research lab website, which is called Rio Mode. Now, having known John, got to know him for over the past sort of, I think, 3 or 4 years especially, got to know his work, particularly in relation to these questions around ecology and its relationship to urbanism and design and design thinking. I've wanted for some time to have him in to speak to our landscape urbanism students, but also to a wider audience at the Architectural Association. So I'm very pleased to be able to do that. Now, what I find particularly interesting and significant in John's work is that rather than simply taking ecology as the object of design, the object of architecture or urbanism, in that very familiar sense that architecture or urban planning is presented with a series of problems that it must kind of remediate, that it must address issues of sustainability and environmentalism, much of his work is concerned kind of recursively with how ecology should impact on design methodology, on how systems thinking and cybernetics should impact upon the practice of design, on the practice of architecture, but also on the very thinking of architecture, on the very thinking of design, and indeed on the thinking of thinking itself. So there's a concern both with the matter of thought and the thought of matter in his work. And furthermore, within his thesis and this soon-to-be-released book, there's a great deal of kind of fascinating research and investigation into some of the key figures throughout the 20th century from whom can be drawn some the kind of means to produce this new thinking, this kind of ecologically and systems originated method of thinking design. And even further back than that, in perhaps a unlikely source of looking to the so-called dialectical materialism of Marx and Engels as perhaps a kind of originating resource for such a mode of thought. So please join me in welcoming to speak to us tonight, Jon Goodbun.
Okay, well, thanks very much, Doug. And that was a pretty useful summary, actually, and I fear that what you successfully said in a couple of minutes, I'm now going to say badly over the course of an hour. Because one of the things I want to try to do this evening, I've been engaged in quite a wide range of different projects, and trying to get them into one talk is something I've been trying to do recently, and this is the latest go at that. As usual, I made some dramatic last-minute changes, so if you see me looking in a confused way at my notes, it just means that I've succeeded in confusing myself for a moment. But hopefully, yeah, hopefully overall there will be something of interest, here. Okay, just by way of a preamble, really. When Doug was asking me for an image, I gave him the one that you see on the screen here. But quite often, actually, I've been positioning it like most people do, with the moon at the base. And it was actually Will McLean I'm indebted to pointing out to me that wasn't actually the way the photograph was taken. And so I did a little bit of background research, and I'll just talk about that briefly now, because I think it's quite a nice, it touches upon a few of the questions. So if you're not familiar with this image, this is an image that was taken in 1968 by Apollo 8. It was actually, in some respects, the result of a campaign that had been going on for a couple of years, which had been led initially by Stuart Brand. Stuart Brand, if you don't know him, was a student of Gregory Bateson, someone that I'll be mentioning this evening. Stuart Brand edited the very influential Whole Earth catalogue through the 60s and 70s, which had a quite dramatic effect upon certain areas of architectural production and thinking about ecological questions, thinking about planning. I'm thinking about planning actually in a couple of different ways, in sort of bottom-up and top-down ways. And it was by Stuart Brand and actually the Whole Earth catalogue. Both of them were quite curious things. They kind of oscillate quite wildly between sort of left and right positions in some respect, or they're kind of left libertarian, I guess, which is a thing to get your head around. As I say, so this image is an interesting thing. So Stuart Brand had been campaigning for a couple of years to get NASA to release an image of the Earth from space. And this hadn't been seen by the public before. And it was, as an artifact, you know, an incredibly influential image. It's singularly, you know, brought into one kind of object, if you like, a whole series of kind of ideas about what the planet might be and how we should think about it. It obviously very dramatically, you know, figures a colourful living object in the midst of at least immediate lifelessness. Intriguingly, the photograph, it happened as Apollo 8 was on a mission to photograph the moon, as it was prior to the moon landings, and they were actually the first ones to go around the far side of the moon and to document that. And this happened, so they weren't actually immediately responding to Stuart Brand's requests, if you like, but NASA were when they did release the image. But basically, as they came around the backside of the moon, they saw, the first time anyone had seen this, and there's not many people who have seen it in real life, they saw the Earth rise as the sun or the moon rises over the Earth. They saw the Earth rise over the moon. The commander, Frank Bowman, was actually, and there's a recording, I was hoping to get it actually, but I couldn't get it, there's a recording or a transcript of the conversation in the capsule, and he was just completely struck by this. He had, he was operating a black and white camera, and so he took the first photograph, and so we see this, you know, literally as it's coming up. Whereas then one of his colleagues who had the bigger colour plates was basically taking it from, so they were literally taking them in these two positions. Now, as he saw the Earth coming up, he read it in the way in which, you know, immediately placed himself upon the planet, upon the, you know, the object, as it were, and so took it from a, you know, in an Earth-like position. His colleague in a different part of the capsule, who was the one who was actually, you know, documenting the moon surface, took the portrait image, which actually is located in relationship to the axis that they were orbiting the Earth. So both images are very kind of coherent in their own terms. Both are kind of curious artifacts in that they, you know, that there are certain, they embody a whole set of relationships about, first of all, these two objects moving in space, then themselves watching this. They themselves are a kind of perceptual apparatus that's capturing this, and the kind of, you know, the necessary ambiguity between the two images and the if you like, the relational, you know, the inbuilt relational qualities of, you know, how do we look at this, that are, I think, sort of quite fascinating as objects, and actually, and in a way they're going to, hopefully, you'll understand what I mean, in that they capture in their relations a number of ways in which I want to talk about relations in general this evening. Okay, and the way this is going to work, at times I'll read from the text, at times I'll talk more freely. Okay. Out of the deep contradictions of global capitalism, an interconnected series of social, political, economic, and ecological crises are emerging. These are transforming cities and regions and environments around the planet in unpredictable and uneven ways, even whilst being generated through them. At the same time, our intellectual tools for thinking about these developments are also changing. My work has focused on how studies of systemic complexity have demanded major revisions in how we think about matter, life, and agency, and what is meant by mind and self. Lessons from disciplines as diverse as quantum mechanics, the cognitive sciences, anthropology, and ecology are suggesting new relational paradigms for thinking about the unfolding dynamics of material and life processes. In my work and in this lecture this evening, I will briefly explore how we might situate a critical research practice within these emerging transdisciplinary configurations. I'm interested in how architecture, as a dialectically autonomous producer of values and concepts, can stage a distinct political engagement with these socio-ecological questions. I want to start by saying something about the frameworks that I see defining the work that I want to talk about this evening. This is partly a theoretical question, simply in terms of positioning the work in relation to a number of contemporary intellectual themes, you might say, which are, yeah, current in you know, the academy and beyond. These would include, perhaps most importantly, the general discussion that's sometimes captured as new materialism, the general discussion that hasn't got a title so much, but the whole body of work looking at cognition and architecture today. There's a useful reader produced by Deborah Houtman a year or two back, would be one example of that. Harry Malgrave's The Architect's Brain would be another, and substantial parts of my work in the PhD and elsewhere has been around that question. It would also include the question of ecological urbanism. Again, there's been a substantial reader positioning, you know, a wide collection of work recently produced by Musavi and published by Harvard. And all of those, yeah, I see my work in relationship too. But I think it's also different to, or you know, it's a particular line within all of those. So one thing is just to, you know, start to place it within a certain intellectual landscape, if you like. But it's also a practical question regarding how to imagine possible forms of architectural research and practice. And I just want to take a couple of minutes to talk about that, because I think it's, whilst it's not directly to do with the content, it's, I think, nonetheless a series of interesting questions confronting, well, I guess people like myself, and so people like people involved in architectural research, as I guess many of you are. So there are today, I believe, a number of interesting attempts to define new kinds of architectural research and practice, not tied to the workings of a professional office organized around the production of buildings, but rather using architectural thinking to engage in broader questions around the urban environment, and indeed beyond. Historians and theorists who in the recent past might have found themselves locating their practice strictly within the spaces of academia are today innovating new forms of practice-based research and activism, often with links to academia still, but actually sort of taking slightly different forms. I think this is partly due to big shifts in both the nature of universities, that the increasing changes in the general intellectual environment that capitalism is producing. So these are kind of sort of curious things. But the kinds of examples that I would use, these are quite interesting guys. Crimson Router, I'm sure you know, spoken here on a couple of occasions. Crimson are a group of historians, architectural historians, but have organized themselves along the lines of an architectural practice and, you know, intervening in urban questions and policy questions, in the manner of, well, partly academics, partly consultants, partly, as I say, practices, but they are, as I say, Crimson architectural historians. That's one interesting model, I think. Liam Young, again, someone based here, has taken on the model of a think tank as a new form of architectural practice, engaged in speculating about future, near future scenarios. Others might include, I was talking to colleagues and one pointed out Steve McAdam of Fluid and Soundings, a double practice. a colleague of mine at the RCA, Tom Greenall, pointed out to me, Steve McAdam is particularly good. His split, this is quoting Tom now, his split model of practice, Soundings and Fluid, is a model that I'm surprised more practices don't adopt. It allows him to run both a critical and a commercial practice and to charge for many of the skills that architects have but typically find difficult to charge for. There's also, so this is a site of another colleague of mine, Philip Visnich. This is a site which I think is, and like actually the next one, Building Blog. Both of these are taking on the forms of, that are allowed by the web to, again, sort of construct a space which is, I think, quite interesting, as a form of practice. That this is looking at ways in which architectural and urban knowledge might be deployed in the world without it being tied to the production of buildings, per se. And of course, if there's anything vaguely interesting going on, then you can be fairly sure that Cool House will go in there and do it bigger. And so, as again, you'll all be familiar with AMO. What does he say here? So the counterpoint to OMA's architectural practice is AMO, a research studio based in Rotterdam. Whilst OMA remains dedicated to the realization of buildings and master plans, AMO operates in areas beyond traditional boundaries of architecture, including media, politics, sociology, renewable energy, technology, fashion, curating, publishing, and graphic design, I'm sure. That list would change and mute. So these were things that I was thinking about as I was trying to think about what I've been doing in recent years and how to how to formulate that. And as Doug kindly mentioned, so I've collected my materials together on Reimagine. And I don't know how I'm sort of still trying to think about how I think about this. So this is it's a blog platform that collects together the various bits of stuff I'm doing, which is primarily teaching and writing these days, plus a couple of research projects which are half in, half out of the academy. And so whether we just think about this as a blog or a kind of feeling towards a way of kind of orientating yourself and making yourself available to the world, if you like, a form of practice. But I found it useful and it seems to be useful for others to do this. So this is how I want to introduce what I want to be talking about this evening. In the middle here, I sort of had a go a while ago at sort of thinking about what is it that I'm doing. And it kind of came down to, and which is still current, sort of four research projects, I guess, that I'm active in. So there's the first one, is scarcity. This is a project which is led by the University of Westminster. It's actually involves a network of institutions across Europe. It's a three-year, it runs out next summer, a three-year funded HERA grant. And I'm going to talk about some of that material briefly this evening. The second project is concerning the political ecologies of concrete, and I'm actually not going to talk about this at all this evening. I spoke about that recently at REBA, as it happens, but as a REBA-funded piece of research. And then there's two pieces of research which kind of come out of the PhD work, but which I'm currently writing with others a couple of funding grants for, as it were, but also trying to have generally been publishing things in those directions. One is concerning reimagining the project of planning, which I'll describe as an urban ecology teaching and research project. And the fourth is space and mind, an ongoing research interest into thinking about the role that ecological, technological, and spatial environments play in our cognitive processes. And these scarcity and planning and space of mind, I'm going to try to combine in a couple of ways to talk you through them this evening. This is a kind of fair bit of material, so I'm leaving stuff out, and I hope it's not too lumpy. Given the paradigm that I've been sort of thinking about, what's the relationship of the theorist and the practitioner in a sense? I was wondering, well, is it possible? Typically when I'm presenting work, you're presenting papers or chapters or whatever. You're at least attempting to talk about something in some level of detail. And so I was wondering, is it possible to present research projects in the way in which a practitioner might present building projects? So I've done in the past. If you're presenting a loads of building projects, you'll actually talk through a whole series of things and try to draw out some connections between them. And I wanted to try to do that this evening with these projects, and we'll see how successful that is. Okay. Now, in the concluding chapter, actually, of what will be the book, I state that throughout this thesis, I've been trying to think about architecture as a producer of concepts which are both experiential and cognitive. Architecture can be used to stage a speculation upon the nature of order. It offers a distinctly aesthetic mode of thinking about systems and the relations between processes as a discipline and a profession, and in its modern form at least, has a curiosity and need to consider a wide range of systems, whether ecological, urban, social, financial, or phenomenological. Such embedded and situated concept formation extends ideas about the individual and the social, the body and the mind, in time and in space. I'm not here restricting architectural knowledge to the production of buildings. Indeed, in the contemporary period, new buildings per se are probably one of the less interesting avenues and applications of architectural research. Maybe I'll talk a bit about this at the end again. Certainly, many of the theoretical studies referred to, or I'll refer to, do not necessarily have immediate tectonic implications. I am rather making a claim for an architectural contribution to contemporary debates concerning ecological thought and the attendant attempts to redefine nature, matter, mind, self, agency, and so on. Within such a formulation, architecture can and does play a distinct role. We might say, indeed, that the architectural event mediates some kind of abstract yet practical conception concerning an extended human natural environment. The architectural proposition is here that which stages and brings into the domain of experience these individual social, political, ecological events. So I'm suggesting that architecture as a body of knowledge, you know, has a loose fit with building. And that actually if you try to define architecture through building alone, you won't actually get very far. Architecture rather is a distinct mode of thought. And if anything, I think it's a reflection upon the nature of order and organization, most fundamentally. Architecture in this sense does have a curious autonomy. This is not to say that architecture is socially autonomous. It is not in any way cut off from the social and the political, far from it. Indeed, as Peter Osborne once noted, the idea that architecture is autonomous in that sense is even more preposterous than the idea that art is autonomous. Nonetheless, there is something interesting in the condition of architecture's particular autonomy and the possibilities that that contains. And that's one of the things I want to talk a bit more further about now. And I think some of these things I'll try to return to at the end. Hang on. Yeah. The question of architectural autonomy has, of course, been raised afresh in the work of several contemporary architectural thinkers. We have heard that the discipline of architecture might be understood as an autopoetic system. Again, one of the colleagues of this building, Patrick Schumacher, has made this assertion. I by no means share all of Schumacher's conclusions, insofar as I'm familiar with them, but I do actually have a great deal of sympathy overall with the attempt and the interest in thinking about architecture as an autopoetic system. My understanding of autopoiesis comes through the theoretical cybernetic biologists Humberto Maturana and Francisco Varela, and it was they who coined the term. Of course, Schumacher has been using primarily Luhmann's reading of autopoiesis, and there are important differences, and Maturana and Varela were cautious about the concept of how the concept of autopoiesis might be deployed outside of biological systems. They weren't completely against it. Indeed, someone that I've got a great deal of time for, Stafford Beer, another cybernetic theorist, did use autopoiesis right from the start to understand human organizations, and in the time that he spent working in Chile was a important or at least had a series of important conversations with Maturana and Varela, and they invited him to write the introduction and preface to autopoiesis and cognition, in which he talked about using autopoiesis to look at cultural systems. So it's certainly a legitimate thing to do, but I think there's some potential things to be alert to. And I'm going to mention autopoiesis a couple of points this evening, I suspect, but it's such an important idea that I want to take a moment to elaborate it further, especially for those of you who might not be familiar with it. Now, autopoiesis is a concept that Maturana and Varela developed out of earlier work in cybernetics, an attempt to define living systems. And for them, an autopoietic system such as a cell, such as a biological cell, is understood, and this is, the, I think, the key of the definition, is understood as a system that feeds back upon itself in such a way that its components are its products, and such that it produces from the inside a boundary. So this is quite complex. I think it's probably worth saying again. So it's a system that feeds back upon itself in such a way that its components are its products. So within a biological cell, you know, there's a series of things inside the cell, and they're kind of, you know, one is feeding the other. They form a closed loop which constructs a boundary. And how we think about the boundary of an autopoietic system is exceptionally important. In a living autopoietic system, such as a cell, the boundary is permeable to flows of matter and energy from its environment, and changes in the flows of an environment can provoke significant reorganizations within a cell. However, the way that these relations are transformed as they interact, or that, you know, these flows of matter and energy are transformed as they interact with and enter the cell, is such that the cell can be considered informationally closed. So this is the key thing. An autopoietic system constructs a boundary which is both open and closed at the same time. And these are diagrams that Mataran and Varela developed, which are now, you might kind of sort of see around in discussion. So the big one on the left here, I guess, is the classic description of an autopoietic system. And what you're seeing here is, first of all, if you like, the big outer loop is describing the production of a boundary. That's the kind of code, but it also, you know, captures it somehow. Then what you're seeing inside is the world within that boundary, if you like. So that's actually that there's kind of, as far as that system is concerned, meaningful information inside there. But that information can't cross the boundary without being absolutely transformed. So the world inside there is changing in response to the environment. The environment in this notation is the squiggly line at the bottom. These two arrows show, if you like, transfer of matter and energy. They show that the autopoietic system is what they describe as structurally coupled, in this instance, to an environment. So you've got a series of different relations going on here. You've got the construction of a boundary, information inside a boundary, and relations to an environment. And if you like, this is various people within cybernetics had been, you know, developing ideas around this for some time, but they particularly nailed it, and partly I think because they were, their position as biologists essentially, that they were watching in perhaps a particularly clear fashion entities that were doing this. So in an autopoietic system, there's a logic and meaning to what happens inside the cell that can only be understood from within the cell. In the work of Mataran and Varela, an autopoietic system brings forth a world, in their terms, internally to itself. Yet the boundary of the cell is both open and closed. Open to matter and energy, but closed to information. And this is what Francisco Varela famously described as a knotty dialectic. And as Doug suggested, one of the bigger, I guess, interests that I've had has been in what I see as two very different but intertwined traditions within systems thinking. One is the tradition that's played out through cybernetics and its various legacies in complexity theory and so on. And the other is a tradition based in dialectical thinking. And there's a big crossover, but I guess one of the things I've been interested in is trying to explore the relations and differences between those two ways of thinking about a world of process. Now, I think that autopoiesis is such a fascinating concept, and I think it's a concept which still the ripples of this actually are going to come. For some time, I think we still haven't properly grasped what cognitive closure in this sense means. But I think one of the things that makes it so fascinating is that it provides a particular kind of dialectical model. Yeah. So one of the senses in which I think it's useful to understand dialectics as a way of grasping paradoxical changing situations. And so the relationship of inside to outside, the nature of a boundary that's simultaneously open and closed, these are, if you like, captured in the way in which they talk about autopoiesis, which I think actually just sheds new light on certain concepts of dialectics, whether within Marxist tradition or others. Now, I'm not sure to what extent architecture can be described as autopoetic, even in the non-biological senses described by Beer and Luhmann. However, whether it is or not, we can be sure that the transformations currently underway in the intellectual and disciplinary environment of architecture, that is to say, in areas of thought outside of but adjacent to architecture, will, or at least can, provoke transformations within the internal structures of architecture in some way. And this is my real area of interest at the moment. How do the massive shifts that are taking place concerning our ideas of matter, mind, and organization affect thinking about architecture? Now, I'll come to that in a second. So there's a series of, just to sort of clarify how you can use this model to, Schumacher or Luhmann initially would use this model to think about organizations and to think about disciplines. And so the point is that the claim, I guess, being made, and which I think I think is a useful claim to make, would be, well, if architecture is like this, or if any discipline is like this, it's a way of understanding disciplinary autonomy. So that it's a way of understanding how a body of knowledge, in this case architecture, actually is always in some sense closed in upon itself, even whilst it's changing in relationship to its environment. And in what way this is working, I think is unclear, how far we can push this. But I think it's a kind of interesting proposition. Okay, so that's one bit of stuff. Now, one of the many interesting tendencies to have emerged from the application of ideas concerning systemic complexity to thinking about the phenomena of such as the organization of matter and living systems being, if you like, this is the particular way in which living material systems organize themselves. So this is, for matter under Ella, the definition of life. There's other ways in which material systems organize themselves, and we'll look at some of that in a moment. But this is the definition of the living as a particular way of self-organizing, such that actually it produces a boundary. So there's a series other interesting ways in which systemic complexity affects how we're thinking about the organization of matter, the workings of the human mind. And a whole series of disciplines which have been working using traditionally quite reductivist models of knowledge production, whether reducing matter down to fundamental particles or consciousness down to neurons or to parts of neurons, whatever. One of the kind of interesting things that's been happening recently, I mean, it depends how you look at that, either very recently or over the last century, is that actually, a whole series of disciplines which were reductive in their method of working, as I say, reducing things down to fundamental particles, have, in a sense, been forced at the smallest moment to then thoroughly expand up and to have to think about the way in which whatever their discipline was, it relates to a bigger environment. And this is one of the, things that I'm going to return to a couple of times, because I think essentially what's kind of happening, and this is a part of the what I think is interesting about possible sort of new work for architectural thinking, if you like, I guess some of my kind of work has been about, is that, you know, physicists can, or, you know, biologists, people looking at the brain, say, actually, that's a better example, have been, you know, reducing and reducing down in some instances, but to the point where actually there's now the clear realization that the plasticity of the brain can't possibly be understood in terms of the brain alone, and that actually you can only understand the development of the brain in terms of its relationship to an environment, to language, to all kinds of social networks. And this presents, you know, an intriguing problem for people in that area, because basically, you know, if you're a neuroscientist, it's very difficult for a neuroscientist to talk about those things, actually. You know, the discipline, you know, their particular, you know, the kind of form of autonomy within their discipline is such that, you know, it's not set up to discuss social or political or ecological questions. And so one of the things that's been happening is that this work that's been needs to be done, which is, you know, on the one hand, looking at the ways in which the kind of knowledge produced by reductivist practices, which is, you know, I don't mean that in a pejorative way at all. I mean, you know, it's what, you know, a vast amount of our knowledge of the world is based upon. But actually, the kind of synthesis of these things has tended to have to happen in other disciplines. And so, in particular, in anthropology, thinking of people like Tim Ingold, in geography, you know, a number of people, you know, Nigel Thrift, Dory Massey, David Harvey. You know, in these kinds of sort of disciplines where, if you like, where there's a looser boundary, is actually where a lot of the synthetic work regarding, you know, if we take the model of the brain, where that's been happening. And in a sense, I think that architecture, or whether it's been missing a trick or not, I don't know, but I think there's you know, scope for architectural work there, which has got nothing to do with buildings or the production of buildings at all, but which is saying that architecture as a particular kind of body of knowledge can actually bring together and reflect upon those things, reflect upon, you know, the nature of order, the way in which, you know, the brain is simultaneously, if you're, you know, neuronal and ecological, in ways in which can't be thought of, you know, in ecology or neurology, if you like, but actually can be staged, possibly, this is the question, within some kind of reflective architectural practice. So, I'll say I'm kind of trying to provide various, what do you say, metaphors taken from bits of theory or bits of scientific practice, and yeah, how this hangs together, we'll see. But these are, just wanted to touch on a couple of examples like this. So these are, again, I think examples which raise in a very intriguing way the question of dialectical conceptions of material organization. This is called Bernard cells. This is essentially, if you like, a proto-living system. This is what we're looking at here. It's just a top view of a bowl that's being heated, a bowl of silicon oil. And so essentially what's being set up there is a metabolism. Metabolism being a key word, actually, that's kind of come out of biology and moved into bigger ecological questions. But essentially, yeah, there's a metabolism being set up, as in there's a flow of energy passing through the system. It's being heated. And what happens here is that the oil then starts to self-organize, that you've got, I think I've got this right, that the kind of dark bits that you're seeing in the middle of these cells is oil rising, and then it's falling in the lighter areas is what we're seeing. And this is one kind of, it's been known as dissipative system, kind of, you know, share some of the aspects of life in a sense, you know, the metabolic systems that require flows of energy, that they're partly understood in relation to ideas around, you know, autopoiesis or self-organisation, in that they are constructing order internally, but actually the reason they're called dissipative systems because they're expelling entropy out into their environment. So they increase order within their boundary, if you like, but increase disorder outside in thermodynamic terms. This is another kind of sort of chemical clock reaction, the Belousov-Zabotinsky reaction, which again has been very popular amongst people like, as a classic work by Ilya Prigogine and Isabel Stengers, who spend some time reflecting upon the nature of these systems. And I think it's useful again to the quote I've got at the bottom here from John Briggs and David Peat, two science, theoretical scientists, describing these systems. And they say, a dispersive system is autonomous, separate. Its autonomy derives from its interdependence with its surroundings. Again, I think that's a kind of key way of understanding a certain kind of dialectical conception. So its autonomy derives from its interdependence with its surroundings. And then I got to say the key to resolving this paradox is how we understand words like process and relationship. We're so used to thinking of things that this may be difficult to grasp at first. And this is in this quote, there's a whole series of things that if I, if this was a seminar series rather than a single one, we might spend more time looking at that. In a sense, a whole part of a kind of sort of paradigm shift I'm trying to sketch out that's starting to emerge is absolutely around relational thinking, but I'm making particular claims for a certain type of relational thinking, dialectical one, and essentially trying to see the world and to develop techniques for seeing the world as a world of process rather than a world of things, or to understand how things are, you know, a particular kind of autonomy, if you like. Okay, so in the cognitive sciences, Alvin Noah has noted that, as we say here, not only can we not explain mind in terms of brain alone, but we can only explain the brain and its role in helping give us minds by thinking about the place of the brain in the context of our interaction with the world. So this is the point that I made slightly early about, you know, this is Alvin Noah, a cognitive theorist, and kind of in this statement, if you like, captures the space that I'm trying to claim for a certain kind of architectural reflection, if you like. Because, you know, explaining the brain, its role in helping to give us minds in the context of our interactions with the world, which then, you know, includes some kind of conception of the world, actually I think involves an arena like architectural thought more than it does neuroscience. And so some of my students will be familiar with this. So one of the things that I've been intrigued by very recently is trying to think, well, how might we sort of push this forwards? And one of the things that I'm trying to get some funding for at the moment is some kind of installation piece around mind and space. And I found the, I don't know if you recognize this. This is from Patrick Keeler's recent installation at the Tate Britain called the Robinson Institute. And though Patrick Keeler is primarily a filmmaker now, he did study architecture. And in a way, I think this is a kind of interesting prototype for a certain kind of architectural research, which brings together very different types of objects. So you've got meteorites, and paintings, you've got bits of text written by the, I don't really want to use the word curator, but I can't think of a better one. you've got bits of text, you know, taken from others. You've basically got this kind of assemblage of objects which is defining or describing or allowing the occupant of the space to grasp, in this case, a set of ideas about landscapes. It's an exhibition of political ecology, I think. And so I thought, well, this is a kind of interesting paradigm for a certain kind of architectural research, perhaps. Okay, so this is, I'm sort of trying to place a few things sort of floating in the air. Now, as you've no doubt guessed from my amount of times that I've used the word system already, there's a few threads that bring together the bits of work that I've been kind of doing, but I guess one of the most important is thinking about the history of systems theory. And I'm particularly intrigued by how architecture might allow a fresh understanding of what is meant by system. And system is one of those words, somehow an awful lot of the vocabulary that I end up having to use are words which quite often in common discourse seem to have slightly like negative associations. So one of my colleagues recently described cybernetics as a ugly name for what she realized was a beautiful idea. And system, I think, again, is one of those words that has all kinds of negative associations, but which actually, if we start to unpick it, we can begin to find some hopefully sort of shift our understanding of it a bit. And so it's interesting to note that system in its modern use emerged in the 1700s, that it was actually absolutely, it was used to grasp living systems. It was part of, for example, William Harvey seeing that the body as a series of circulation systems. System is right from the start about seeing actually how the vital processes of organizations, and in particular, initially living systems. So with that initial softening of the concept, to talk about systems thinking in architecture a little bit. Because one of the, describe some different research projects that I'm engaging in, one of the particular ways that I'm trying to think about this vague exhibition installation thing, it's about space and mind, is actually using architecture to stage a reflection upon systems. Now, which I think is actually particularly proper to architecture. So systems thinking in architecture generally is considered to be a 20th century phenomenon. Beginning perhaps with the proposals for the rationalization of the construction industry by Ernst May in Weimar Germany, or with the emergence of the French concrete industry as a system of prefabrication. In the post-war period, systems approaches to construction were taken up on both sides of the Iron Curtain. Let me see there. But to very different aesthetic and ideological ends. Whereas in the Soviet Union, systems theory was at least partially taken up in the sense anticipated by May, that is to say, as a means of implementing planning. In the capitalist West, it took on an apparently very different role and was concerned with giving form to a society increasingly organized and valorized around information. In the Soviet bloc, systems models dominated construction methodology, but typically these were precast concrete panel systems, like this example from East Germany. Precast concrete panel systems, it's actually the only thing I'll say about concrete this evening, which were heavy in every sense of the word. In the West, a very different tradition emerged. In the United States, for example, for Eero Saarinen, the Eames, and perhaps most notably Buckminster Fuller, and in the UK, for example, Archigram or Cedric Price. The implementation of systems thinking and cybernetics became associated with a particular form of techno-utopianism, and increasingly gave expression to an immaterialization of construction. However, I want to argue that all of the above are just a few moments in a much more complex relationship between architectural knowledge and systems thinking. In fact, the nature of the nature of architecture's engagement with systems thinking has been profoundly complex in the full sense of the term. Architecture is itself a system, even whilst it mediates other systems, we described earlier a little. It is complicit within the production of bigger systems, economic, social, infrastructural, and ecological, and it is essential to the reproduction of smaller systems, most notably the human organism and, I think, human consciousness. I'm trying to draw together a series of moments in systems thinking, as it has developed over the past two centuries in particular, and given you some moments of that already. These are drawn from necessarily a range of disciplines. Systems thinking is characterized as kind of sort of necessarily transdisciplinary work. In some ways, it's about abstracting ideas of organization from very different concrete models. I mean, concrete in the philosophical sense there. And in terms of architecture's relationship to systems thinking, whilst there was presumably little self-conscious reflection upon architecture as an abstract system and a system of abstraction in the collective historical activity of, say, human city building vernacularly, by the time we get to the Renaissance, this situation has changed dramatically. Here we find the emergence of modern architecture, I think, self-consciously describing itself as a professional knowledge and discipline. And we find it, I think, and this is something which hasn't been especially remarked upon as far as I can see from others, we find it self-consciously theorizing itself as a systems theory. And in fact, the reason why I think architecture might offer a particularly useful site for reflecting upon systems in general today is that actually architecture in many respects was possibly the first systems theory. In, for example, Leon Battista Alberti's theory of Concinitas, as set out in De Re Edificatoria, we find, in the words of Adrian Forti, a principle of harmony that underlies the graceful arrangement of parts in relation to each other and to the whole. And this language of a relation to parts, whole-part relations, is central to the development of systems thinking. Although there's obviously other kinds of models of varying complexity and so on have more recently emerged. Architecture, here specifically the facade, is theorized by Alberti as a concept which emerges as a systemic relationship between whole and parts. Alberti says, beauty is a form of sympathy and consonance of the parts within a body. And he's in fact suggesting that aesthetics in this sense is what would later in cybernetics be seen as a second order effect, a self-empathy or a closed cognitive loop, if you like, referring to earlier things, within an organism. And we might even understand architecture as second-order building, which I think is one of the closest ways of getting architecture to building. I'm suggesting here, in a sense, in parallel to Fuhrer's description of architecture's role in the ideological formulation of the project of the plan, that in some sense, systems theory in general was first imagined as a possibility, as a conceptual form, in this architectural moment. Various conceptions of relationships between part and whole, have driven huge amounts of systems thinking, and we can see it in a couple of the material examples I gave earlier, and a couple more that we might look at ever briefly in a moment. And if we find If we find the whole part dialectic to have been self-consciously articulated first in Renaissance architecture, this might be because, as de Fury spent much of his career revealing, the Renaissance is that space in which the present finds its problems. It is in this period that we find the birth of the system of modernity, the birth of architecture as it is understood today, as both a systems discipline and frequently as a thoroughly ideological system of spatio-temporal projection. But more than this grounding in the professions work of Alberti, say, it goes much further than that. In fact, I would argue that since Alberti, and as William Branham and Jonathan Hale have shown in I think the kind of meta story that emerges in their collection of essays, Rethinking Technology, there has been, certainly since the Industrial Revolution, there's been a consistent re-engagement between modern architecture and systems theory, and a consistent attempt to define attempt to define an architectural practice as a form of systems theory, articulated through various concepts articulated around nature, technology, organism, and ecology. For Branham and Hale, the repeated engagements with systems theory and architecture must be comprehended within the context of their broader social and economic conditions, in which all aspects of architectural production were undergoing constant radical transformation. As a result, many architects tried many different formulations to manage and understand these changes. Principal among them were various kinds of organic and biological analogies, they state, which gained increasing precision as cybernetics, systems theory, and complexity analysis matured. Branham and Hale emphasize that at the same time as architects were attempting to understand the technological transformations of modernity through developments in systems theory broadly and biological thinking specifically, they state that those same developments were changing the understanding of organic life itself. In other words, as new paradigms of explanation developed, they were applied equally to buildings, bodies, and machines. I think this is a key point to grasp. Okay, I just want to, so I'm trying to move backwards and forwards between giving you metaphors to think about and reflecting upon them in architecture. And this is, back to Stafford Beer again, who I mentioned earlier, and this is a table that he produced, which, essentially Stafford Beer argued this is sort of relatively mature cybernetics work, if you like, so it's late 60s. And Beer argued in this table and in his work in general that basically pretty much all of the phenomena in the universe can be reduced down to, and it is a kind of reduction, reduced down to three different kinds: simple systems, complex systems, and exceedingly complex systems. And within that, he then split up to other actors, deterministic and probabilistic. And what's interesting in this diagram is that it actually kind of sort of captures something of the history of scientific metaphysics, if you like, for want of a better word. So you're kind of going from a idea of a deterministic universe to an idea of a universe in which, in terms of complex systems, their behavior cannot in any simple way be planned or predicted. And actually, Beer's work, I think, he was a fascinating guy, but he could deserve a lecture or more on his own. He worked with, famously worked with Salvador Allende's government in Chile a couple of years after writing this. Beer was, despite being exceptionally at times tied into the workings of capitalism, was actually always politically radical and was approached by Allende and the head technician Flores, a guy called Flores, and at the time where they were essentially trying to, or not trying, they were nationalizing Chile's economy and were trying to come up with new models for how can you plan an economy. And Allende, as you may know, was essentially an elected Marxist, but absolutely not of the Soviet variety. Stafford Beer was absolutely scathing of Soviet attempts to plan an economy. And essentially, I think we can use this as a way of grasping some of the things that I'd like to allude to about planning in general. But also, I think one of the key insights, hopefully insight at least, that I've grasped from looking at the different traditions of systems thinking. And these are that, if you like, there's two, actually, what's often presented as a unified body, actually contains two very, very different strands. There's what we might call systems thinking in general, which was to do with, at least in large part, and in lots of its funding, was actually to do with attempting to manage and control complex systems, whether these were economies or ecologies or early developments or even conceptions of what computers might be and so on. And yet within cybernetics, through people like Beer, through people like Bateson, it became clear that actually an awful lot of complex systems were actually simply can't be. There's an epistemological problem. They simply cannot be predicted and controlled in those ways. And so when Allende went to Beer, he was essentially sort of saying, well, we don't want the kind of top-down planning that you see the Soviet Union trying to implement and necessarily failing because of the, you can understand in cybernetics why that particular kind of top-down model can't work. But equally, we don't believe, we can see how it fails, the kind of, what's still so popular today, ideas of bottom-up work as being, necessarily sort of valorized as good, that this is actually, just a straightforward market, hidden market ideology, if you like. But are there ways in which we can engage with complex systems which are neither neither valorizing top-down or bottom-up models, but which are attempting to couple ourselves to systems in such a way as you might exert a direction, but where you're essentially having an open-ended relationship to the future? And I think Stafford Beer offers a fascinating model for us today, not only in terms of, in terms of thinking about questions around planning, but also questions around how can we restructure economies and so on. So if I get a chance, I'll speak a bit more directly to that. I'm going to have to jump through some stuff because I wasn't sure quite how long this was going to take. So, I mean, just to tie up some of this kind of overview, if you like. So one of the striking shifts that this kind of thinking is based upon is a transformation that's occurred in thinking about what matter is, between, it's still very much underway, but between, since the Enlightenment. And there's a couple of quotes here, which I won't read through, but you can find easily enough, which essentially early kind of Enlightenment ideas, which are seeing the material universe as, A, essentially made up of particles, which, you get to a certain point and, it is just lumps of stuff. That these are acting in the Beer sense, to go back, in a deterministic manner, like billiard balls. So Laplace the famous French scientist suggests that if we knew where all of the atoms in the universe were and where they were moving, then we'd be able to predict the future of the universe. It was seen as a kind of mechanistic model. And that wasn't really, that seemed to be right. And in fact, in a common sense way, I suspect that an awful lot of people would not necessarily immediately have the tools to unpick what's wrong with that. However, we do know that it's absolutely wrong. And it became increasingly clear in the development of scientific thinking, two different, if you like, tendencies, which so much of this stuff, I think, has fantastically rich origins for us today in the work of the mid to late 19th century. And at this point, you can see, as I mentioned earlier, a certain kind of science following a reductivist method of looking for smaller and smaller particles, things, and so on. At the same time, you had the sciences of life emerging, where that just would not work at all. And so you had, a crossing over between the life sciences and the physical sciences, precisely around the question of form and order and how matter is organized. This is actually a 17th century image. In fact, this is a hook. I'm going to have to jump through some of this stuff. But as the Engels in particular, I've found to be just quite prescient in regards to future developments in systems thinking in a way in which I think is quite useful for us today. In his Dialectics of Nature, he states, "The world is not to be comprehended as a complex of ready-made things, but as a complex of processes, in which apparently stable things, no less than the concepts, the mental reflections in our head, go for an uninterrupted change of coming into being and passing away." And so we see an attempt to move beyond a model of looking at the world as a bunch of things and an attempt to look at it as a network of processes. There's a whole, I spend a lot of time looking at or considering how what this means in relationship to actually Marxist philosophy more generally, because it's as Doug alluded, the application of this to material world within Marxist circles is becoming incredibly unfashionable. But actually, it's, given time, maybe I should sort of stay where that is. I mean, what's kind of ended up happening is in today, the attempts to describe complex systems have essentially been left to either the way in which they often describe themselves is flat ontological models. So systems which are essentially just network models. Now this is, these are pretty good things. I mean, there's some excellent work in there. I do think so. But actually, there's a whole series of contradictions within those models, which become quite significant at times. And if I had time, I would talk about a whole series of these contradictions, which focus around the question of emergence, which emergence obviously feeds into architectural thought in all kinds of ways, although in a very simplified sense. And it is, I think it's striking that the dialectical model provides a very different alternative to the flat ontologies, I think, and one which allows it's actually much better at grasping the kind of thing that Matter and Nirvana were doing, which is why they describe themselves as dialecticians in any case, where you can understand that there are internally defined worlds. We can hold on to different conceptions, holding things like nature and culture as different things, even whilst understanding them as absolutely, at times, intertwined things. Now, I'm just going to have to jump through some of this stuff, but this is questions which were going on in the 19th century, around the self-organization of matter, and this is Ernst Haeckel, who was the founder of ecology, or the person who coined the term, at least, and who was he and his student Dreyesh, who were particularly fascinated, as a whole series of people at the time were, with embryology. But, you know, and the question, where is the form coming from? And there were a series of attempted answers to this, which kind of, you know, range from God to vitalism to more recently ideas about it being contained within the DNA of the cell. But these kind of questions of where is the form coming from being, if you like, a key dynamic, which was actually working within architecture and biology at the same time. This is kind of one of the interesting things, is that the concept of form underwent huge development at this time, and I think is today. And actually that this development goes on simultaneously in terms of the organization of matter and its self-organization and the question of where does the form come from, but also in terms of perception. So form was an aesthetic concept. And that actually, it's not coincidental that the two things are connected. And for actually, if you can remember the earlier Varela quote, that kind of sets out why. Now, so just can't talk about this, but one of the things that happened in the early 20th century was an awful lot of the things that were grasped around holistic systems, about looking at bigger patterns of organization that were initially happening in the life sciences, then started to play out across the actually the physical sciences. And so first of all in relativity theory, and then in quantum mechanics, essentially a whole series of ways in which, you know, they realized that once you get to the very small, you need to grasp the whole thing again. And David Bohm was a theoretical physicist that I find particularly fascinating, and kind of sort of pointing out that actually, you know, you get down to the electron, but then actually you need to start considering the whole of space, and that actually these models of particles are actually fundamentally flawed, that we're better off, in his description, thinking about electrons as something like the top right diagram. You know, these aren't objects in an empty space. They're actually absolutely constituted out of and constitute space. And that we need to understand these things as processes rather than objects. And it's curious that we still haven't got away from that language. So, when you read the popular discussions around, say, you know, what CERN is doing today, it's still talked about as a search for fundamental particles. People talk about the Higgs boson being a particle, which it just isn't. You know, these things are not particles. They're entities, they're processes, but they're not particles in any common sense of the word. Right. Now, this was probably the best piece of art that I saw this year. This was a documenta. I don't know if anyone saw this. Anton Zeilinger, the theoretical physicist, basically just set up the physics experiment. I was going to show you the movies, but I haven't got time. Essentially, this is a demonstration of wave-particle duality. Again, fantastically bad way of thinking about what's going on in material systems. But you've got basically an electron emitter that bounces around, and you were able, the two buttons, the red and the green, allowed you to move a plate that allowed it to either, the electrons to either be passing through one slit or two slits. And if you're familiar with the experiment, then what happens and what you see happening in the right hand, so the left hand image here, is on the left hand of the screen, it's actually showing you, I mean, the two slits are tiny, so this is a highly magnified camera showing that you've opened both slits. And then you get a diffraction pattern emerging. And so, I really don't think I've got time to show you the videos. But what we're seeing on this screen up here is a series of lines are the diffraction pattern. This is, you know, exactly as if you've got a tank of water. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with this. So pass a tank of water through two holes and the two waves combine and you get a series of peaks and troughs. However, we know that these are discrete electrons, which are in common terms thought of as particles, which are hitting the detection screen. So they're forming a wave pattern, but they're arriving one by one. And if you close one of the loops so that you don't get the interference, then you just get a bundle of them. Fascinatingly, if you put a detector next to either of the slits so that you can try and pass, see where it's coming from, so you have an electron which you know is leaving the electron emitter, you know that one arrives. If you put a detector on one of the slits, then actually it stops it working and you just get two piles of stuff arriving. So in some way, each particle process, shall we say, knows that both slits are open, even though it's effectively only, if you think of it as a particle passing through one. This is, I could talk about this at some time, partly just out of frustration at the language that scientists continue to use, but even in terms of wave particle dualism, I mean, it's just, again, it's just wrong, actually. I mean, these are processes which, depending upon what you do to them, either form wave-like things or particle-like things, but they are that totality. It's not, it's not a dualism. Okay, this question of form, is something which not only affects the way in which material self-organizes, but it affects the way in which material systems self-organize. It affects, as I've said, the relationship of the growth of the body as much as the self-organization of the Bernard cells or so on that we saw earlier. We've seen attempts to discuss where this might be coming from, whether sort of vitalistic attempts or theories of self-organized or theories of it actually being contained within of kind of reductive models of the code. This is Dawkins' position, which I think is quite wrong in that sense. And that actually a whole series of definitions of this understanding actually form as always a process-based thing have essentially been emerging in particular since the 1970s and in the work of people like Stuart Kaufman, Ilya Prigozhin, Bateson, Maturana and Varela, we saw earlier, a series of ways in which this has been thought about, which I, apart from what I said already, I can't really go through. Tim Ingold, who I mentioned earlier, in a sense, this is anthropology, but it's kind of interesting question. Why is it that this is actually in anthropology that these things get most thoroughly reflected upon at the moment? And as I'm sort of saying, I think architecture can potentially be hosting this discussion too, in rather different ways. I'm just going to have to jump through this. How am I doing? There's loads more that I wanted to talk about, but I think time-wise, I'm probably going to have to wrap it up here. Yeah, so maybe I will end on this quote. Okay, it's not quite ideal, but it's basically one of the things I was hoping to sketch out for you is the way in which this thinking about processes and these self-organizing material systems actually is always, or there's a series of quite difficult discussions going on at the moment about the way in which whenever humans are involved, we're talking about political ecologies, about whether we can talk about the politics of this, just in terms of material discussion. And again, I think that, as I've been suggesting, that actually the general language of self-organization and emergence and so on, which is been doing, you know, is fashionable in all kinds of ways, is actually full of problems. And that actually the kind of dialectical approach that you can find in nascent form, to be sure, in Marx and Engels, but which I think there's a interesting job that potentially we can do now to flesh it out, given actually some of the ways in which things like Matter and Honor and Varela's work, I think provides a kind of more interesting grasp of dialectical models. And I think all of that is captured in this, to some extent, captured in this quote by Engels, which does grasp, I think, in interesting ways, both anticipates all kinds of things that we would see in 20th century systems thinking, but that actually grasps a very political ecology. So Engels is talking here about the human relation to nature. And I think, I'll tell you something again. So he says, "Let us not flatter ourselves overmuch on account of our human victories over nature. For each such victory takes its revenge on us. Each victory, it is true, in the first place, brings about the results that we expected, but in the second and third places has quite different unforeseen effects, which only too often cancel out the first." And I think already, I mean, if we reflect upon that sentence, he's already in there anticipating a language of feedback, a language of second order effects, a language of recursion. So in the second and third places. He says, "The people who in Mesopotamia, Greece, Asia Minor and elsewhere destroyed the forest to obtain cultivable land never dreamed that by removing along with the forests the collecting centers and reservoirs of moisture, they were laying the basis for the present forlorn state of those countries. When the Italians of the Alps used up the pine forests on the southern slopes, so carefully cherished on the northern slopes, they had no inkling that by doing so they were cutting at the roots of the dairy industry in their region. They still had less inkling that they were thereby depriving their mountain springs of water for the greater part of the year, and making it possible for them to pour still more furious torrents on the plains during the rainy seasons." He goes on, "Thus at every step that we are reminded that we by no means rule over nature like a conqueror over foreign people," as in one idea of the nature-culture relation, "like someone standing outside of nature, but that we with flesh, blood and brain belong to nature and exist in its midst." And I think, coming from this pair of thinkers, this is a particularly intriguing statement, if you like. And if I conclude, even though there's a whole lot of stuff I wanted to talk about, which I haven't, If we conclude by reflecting back on the things I said about Stafford Beer's relationship to planning, then we're seeing here in Engels, so this is obviously someone who typically you would associate with planning, someone who, he's certainly not ruling it out, but anyway, I mean, that's not what I'm trying to suggest, but he's basically making clear that our conceptions of planning can't possibly be of the command and control variety. And that actually, in a fascinating way, I think this statement just completely undermines, for example, the kinds of planning of economies that were played out across Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union in all kinds of ways. Because he's sort of saying, no, the complex systems just don't behave like that. That you've actually got to be ready for unforeseen consequences, because that's the nature of complex systems. But that's then not to, this isn't saying give up and take on a bottom-up thing that has to be bottom-up or it's no good, because that's actually deeply flawed and I haven't got time to discuss the full reasons of that. But it's basically, posing a question about how can we try to take some kind of conception of planning, but which is something else. And, I think that something else is something that we very clearly do need to do, given time, although I'm sure I don't really need to, that the exceptional state that we're in ecologically, environmentally, suggests that our very models of economics, of regional and city planning and so on, such that they barely are anyway, taking us to a series of major crises. So, and these are, you know, pretty close to bottom-up systems that we're playing through at the moment. So we clearly need to, just in terms of the preservation of civilization, need to come up with some different models of planning that can enable us to couple to environments in different ways. And I think that, in some way, you know, staging this as a question, as an architectural question, is actually the main thing for us to be doing in architecture right now. That architecture, I think, can reflect upon the nature of order, the nature of material systems, the nature of living systems, and the nature of social systems in ways that might initially look more like the Patrick Keeler installation in terms of thought processes. I don't think this is anything particularly to do with buildings right now, but it is to do with a certain need to reimagine how we might couple ourselves to complex material living systems. And whilst I'll go away and realise that I need to spectacularly revise my ambitions for what I can squeeze into a lecture, I guess I'll leave it there. Reveal the extent of my bad planning.
Okay, I'll maybe kick off expose myself to a badly formulated comment, not even a question really. But I just think, as you can kind of guess, the kind of question I'm going to ask from previous conversations. But you've alluded to the real kind of complexities of trying to think politically about all of this, and kind of particularly in terms of how one thinks about the politics of architecture with your references to autonomy. I can't help but kind of go back to your references to Alberti and think about how rich these are, having recently kind of delved into Chafuri's writings about the Renaissance, mm-hmm. where he's very concerned to kind of point out that we've got this conjunction here of like the birth of modern capitalism and of humanism and of certain types of scientific and technological knowledge,
yep.
and that these are all kind of implicated
yep.
with one another, yep. so that and with understandings of nature as well at the same time, and that I think the point I'd like to make really is that much of what you're presenting, without wishing to caricature it, is concerned with the observance of models or the deriving models from nature and then deriving from those ways of operating.
Well, it's partly that, but actually it's also saying, it's partly saying, well, there's lots, you know, the landscape around architecture is absolutely transforming in how we think about mind, in how we think about matter, and so on, and that there's kind of, you know, lessons for us to take in.
Mm.
But it's actually equally saying that I think there's real contributions that architecture can make, partly because of its at least semi-autopoietic status, actually in, you know, it's actually got contributions to make to thinking about, yeah, complex systems and living systems. So it's actually it's a two-way,
right.
It's a two-way thing, and that that actually I think that, like geography and anthropology, but actually different. You know, in architecture it would look different to both of those. It would look different to the kind of thing that, you know, Massey does or Ingold does, although it share a lot of characteristics, but that I think, you know, architecture can bring together a whole series of these questions. When you were talking, when you started talking, I thought you were going to go in a slightly different direction, and so I've got another answer for you if you went in that direction, actually, as well, or it prompted me to think about something, which is something that I had wanted to get onto at the end, which is, yeah, if we look at the birth of the modern conception of architecture in the Renaissance and in Alberti, well, on the one hand, we have a model which is emerging at the beginnings of capitalism, but which is actually, as I think, again, another of your colleagues here, as Aureli has kind of made clear, actually, interestingly, and if I understand it correctly, if you like, there's a the city of Alberti is actually, it's a homeostatic city. It's not one that's growing, and so the kind of the classical model the model of the Renaissance city actually ends up on the one hand it was backwards facing, in a sense, it was drawing upon a classical language, but it was about a fixed notion of the city, which actually ended up flipping in all kinds of ways once capitalism really got going. But also at that point, and this is, if I understand correctly, Aureli's point, that actually that you then get to a point today where we can say, well, architecture and urbanism on this model are actually very, very different things. And contain, are very different bodies of knowledge that, if you like, the political potential of architecture is in its autonomous, semi-autopoetic moment to some extent. The fact that it can articulate a reality in a way which is internal to architecture to some extent and not driven by the processes of capital, and that we can understand. If we're contrasting architecture and urbanism, then we can understand urbanism as just purely the processes of capitalism at work in the environment. Mm. So first of all, we have that. And one of the things that I think really struck me as I was sort of thinking about that, and which is something that I'm trying to sort of think through at the moment, is well, if we then fold this into a kind of political ecology question, then it actually kind of works rather well. And I alluded to the Harvard collection on ecological materialism, ecological urbanism, earlier. And whilst there's, you know, there's lots and lots of interesting material in there, it absolutely does fit that model of urbanism. Yeah, this is, I mean, it's yeah, I don't think Marx or anyone else foresaw quite how short-sighted our political and economic leaders would be, but if they were a bit more at least trying to run their own system properly, they'd largely implement the stuff in that ecological urbanism reader, right?
Yes.
That's, yeah. So whilst there's lots of things that I would applaud in there, it's actually still, it's about capitalistic processes, and it's actually about that sense of ecology, which was one of its originally things, as a means of managing environments for capitalism.
Yeah, I mean, so this is kind of precisely, that's one of my concerns, is that it's what we can have too easily obscured is the fact that, to some extent, we're finding the type of nature that we want to legitimate capitalism.
Yeah.
Look, if you think about how often, you know, terms like efficiency and productivity are imputed to nature, whereas there are other arguments, as we know, that might say that you can look at nature and say it's incredibly wasteful.
Yeah, absolutely.
exuberant.
Yeah.
So we kind of produce certain models produce a kind of nature model of nature that is legitimating and authorizing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Of course. Yeah.
Can I just actually, before you do, can I just get one further sentence in to tie up? Basically, one of the things I'm trying to work out at the moment is if actually pretty much all of the discourse around ecological urbanism, whilst it would be, in many respects better than the systems of transforming the environment that we're currently using, it's still essentially an ecological form of urbanism as the process of capital upon the environment. And so the question then is posed is, if we think of Aureli's distinction between urbanism and architecture, if we change urbanism to ecological urbanism, the question is then posed, is there, as an alternative to ecological urbanism, something like the architecture of the ecological city, or so. A completely different logic of what it might be, which actually would be the real political challenge to. Do you want?
The question, I think this is a question, it's to do with the, I'm not quite sure how to describe them, that the, if you like, the scientific experiments or demonstrations, you showed some images of such things that are that are made by architects or that are made in architecture. And somehow there's a suggestion that these things are in some way point towards the architecture of an ecological architecture as opposed to an ecological urbanism.
Yeah, right. Yep.
But then there's a side of my brain that thinks, well, what stops these things from simply being, and maybe they aren't simple, but anyway, the kinds of demonstrations that are put on in museums and art galleries as spectacles for the public in order to, for the public to come to love science?
I think that's a really good question. It's something in a slightly different form I've been wondering myself as I've been trying to imagine this kind of idea that I've got emerging for doing something about systems, space and mind as a kind of somewhere between a curated piece of work and an installation or whatever. I think that's a good question to ask, and I don't have a straightforward answer to that.
Yeah. I think it would be good to have an answer. I don't mean in terms of saying it, but in terms of doing it, because I think there's something about the Keeler piece is okay, but it doesn't do anything.
Yeah. Well, it does in your head, but yes.
Yes. But
yes.
That thing then becomes the model that then informs how you might think about architecture as in relationship to it.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the answer to your previous question, and given what you're saying, I mean, is no, there's nothing that would stop it being a spectacle. And it would end up being that to some extent, until you are able to get to a point where actually these things were real social and ecological relations. But that's just not on the cards remotely. And at the moment it seems that there's important work to do to even just try to think about and construct different imaginary models of what it might be to couple ourselves to different kinds of systems and to reflect more carefully upon our own world that we bring forth and the worlds of other entities. Yeah. Does that answer?
I think it's quite interesting the fact that you have somehow described the difference between a project that you could call architectural and could strive to define itself as autonomous, and another project which in a way is the question of what is the architecture of the ecological city or whatever that city may be, which ends up being an urban project or a project of architectural urbanism, but urbanism at the end of the day. And because you've mentioned so many times the idea of putting process as a forefront of the way in which we think, I was just thinking about this text of David Harvey that in a way describes the need to have a model to which to strive. But in a way he asks or asks the question what a processual model or a processual utopia may be, as opposed to a formal utopia. The fundamental thing is if we want to fabricate a special discourse on the city, we end up having to draw something. So if we cannot draw a utopia, what do we draw? Which, I mean, shall we probably draw more, or shall we,
Well, again, that's kind of, I think, what I find intriguing about the Keeler piece, is that, and I know you're using draw in a bigger sense than simply drawing. But if we think of that kind of installation as a big drawing, if you like, it seems like, yes, we do need to draw, to try and imagine political possibility. But it just seems that the things that need to be within that drawing is actually just this mix of quite real stuff, right? And ultimately, it's that the drawing becomes real, so that you even start to include real social relations within that, but is the utopian idea, I guess, at least, isn't it? I mean, the power of it, yeah. I don't know if that spoke to what, yeah.
Firstly, I want to say thank you for a really exciting talk. There's several things that I could try and comment on or try and form a question on. But I'll go to the very first slide that you showed, which it really struck me this time in seeing it. What's extraordinary about it is, firstly, the absence of the sun, which is an integral part of or integral driver of the system, but also a complete absence of stars and the rest of the cosmos, and therefore, in that image, there's a sort of denial of the cosmology that is sort of inherent in the way that we think of the world and our role in it. I mean, it's just a kind of comment, but I'd like to kind of throw it towards you to see.
Well, I mean, I think that's actually, because I do find those images very intriguing as artifacts, and I think the things that you've identified are all part of that it's about. It's not about describing everything. It's actually a very particular new view on actually some old ideas about what the planet is, in a sense. So I think you're right that probably part of its power is that those things aren't there, actually. If they were there, if it was everything. There's actually an image that I've also become fascinated by recently, again produced by NASA, a recent image which actually does include doesn't include the sun, but it does include the sun. It's these images that, these time-lapse photographs that were produced by the International Space Station recently, which I don't even have, they weren't even a part of the extended version of this, but which are quite extraordinary things, because they're time-lapse photographs, so you basically see this mix of different systems. You see the stars rotating, and so you see this sweep of stuff, but you're seeing the planet rotating, and what you then primarily see are these swipes of light. So absolutely, if you haven't seen them, they're really quite extraordinary images that were released 3 or 4 months ago, which maybe do, I think are so interesting because they capture quite accurately a shift in how we think about ecology, actually. So the shift from a kind of late 60s version of ecology, which was actually this kind of pristine planet, to actually this vision of ecology where the main thing we see on the planet are our own lights, but you're still seeing it as part of a bigger. I think there's a lot that could be said about discussed about these things. Yeah. Keep it simple.
I think it's a question about thinking about this last Engels quote and what you said, that, and it echoing with what you were saying about Staffordshire and complex, or particularly extremely complex systems in his lovely taxonomy. Yeah. And what works, you said, planning like this can't work because that's not the way things work. Right, that's not what I mean. So there's a quick question in here about the status that, what effectively become necessarily ontological claims, or claims just about the way things are in relation to certain kinds of practices. So you abstract out of, the being is relational. And then you can trace that across a series of quite different philosophical and scientific models which may or may not think of themselves as actually addressing that in ontological terms about being in general, but you can reduce it to that idea, and that would be fine. But if that is just the way things are, if that's just the way things work, then the problem, as I see it, with the argument then kind of politically and socially is every form of planning must turn out to be that way because that's simply the way things are anyway. Do you see what I mean? So what's the status of the things that in some way conform to the reality, unless one then begins to invoke a slightly problematically kind of naturalistic ethics in which we ought to do these things the way because that's the true, truly the way things are. So we ought to do things processionally because in reality things are processional. But if in reality everything is processional, then it doesn't matter what you do because it's going to be processional anyway. So what's the point of striving to be, to practice in an expanded sense, not necessarily building buildings, in a particular way? Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it does make sense, yeah. Well, first of all, one of the things that I think hopefully, I don't know if it would have been or not, but would have tried to flesh out a bit more, I think to some extent would have spoken to some of that, which is that yes, whilst it's about a process ontology, for want of a better word, it's then actually saying, I think the question of planning is more interesting, and it's actually that I'm not trying to just sort of say, oh, we need a process-based view of planning, but that actually, that what's, if we look at, and this is why I think the neo-cybernetic stuff is still so interesting, is that what they ended up looking at is essentially ways in which that there are just very, very different kinds of system, actually. So this is the point, that it's not just that there's process and that's it, that actually the world is full of very, very different kinds of processes that actually, this is kind of one of my big problems with general stuff around emergence and self-organization and so on, is that, and especially by the time it ends up in architecture and urbanism, is it such a simplified version of this quite often, which is often doing little more than, you know, supporting, you know, quite trivial senses of bottom-up stuff, but with, you know, a whole ideology behind it, of markets and so on hidden. But this much more complex version of processes, which is, I think, and this is why a kind of dialectical response is needed, because you've actually got different kinds of, this is one of the problems, we don't have a very good language for talking about any of this, because I could sort of say, you know, what happens when things get nested within nested things, and it starts to sound a bit hierarchical, but actually it's not necessarily, it could be, I mean, yeah, Bateson used this word, sort of plateau, to describe these kind of sort of points of stability or internally organized things. You've got, what Beer did that was so interesting, I think, is said that, well, one of the ways in which you can, you know, that there is a political moment here, actually, he takes partly from the human models of human consciousness within some of this thinking, which essentially is about a series of slightly nested feedback loops, so that you do have ambitions about planning, but that you're constantly, just watching how things unfold, and that this is partly that, you know, it's neither top down or bottom up, as I'm sort of saying, but it's actually just about coupling yourself in various ways. But that I think that does, it suggests that, no, there are very, very different kinds of processes. Some have agency upon other processes. That there is, you know, in the full sense of the word, a kind of political ecology there. Does that? It's not about sort of saying, oh, right, it's just process, and therefore we do process, and as you then say, well, it doesn't matter, because obviously top-down planning is as much a part of a process as, you know.
Yeah. I suppose the next question would be how you mediate those different levels. I mean, how do you get from those more or less wide ontological or physical claims to those specific processes? Because I was thinking about the term like self-organization. It's always to me as bizarre. What would it mean not to think that things were self-organized.
Yeah.
You'd have to be an idealist or a theologian. You know,
yeah, absolutely.
It's crazy to imagine that matter is not self-organized. Yes. What the hell else is organizing it? But precisely for that reason, it kind of risks being a meaningless term, which I think you're right, when it then moves into things like architectural discourse, it becomes so broad as to be effectively useless.
Yeah, I mean, I agree.
We've got time for one quick question.
I found very interesting the killer exhibition, the installation, and I thought that perhaps that was the most clear example of an actual project that you gave tonight that really helped me in understanding your thinking process, basically. And in respect to that, you mentioned the word assemblage and self-empathy between objects. From my point of view, I would see self-empathy as a sort of step up further in understanding this type of assemblage. Otherwise, we would, in a way, go back in some kind of composition that we have seen. I would say, for example, in during the 80s or many other examples of. Design or stylistic approach to architecture or to space configuration. So, if you would like to perhaps give a few qualification or characterization of self-empathy between objects, I think that would help in understanding better your point.
Okay, well, I'll try and do one then. I think this is part of a component to an answer to David's previous question as well, actually, about what would do them mediating in a conceptual way. This is an example from Gregory Bateson, and it's basically it was his notion of abduction. And abduction for him is a particular, it's actually a process of metaphor, essentially. And it can be visualized in a very simple way, if you like, as moiré patterns. So when you've got, a couple of field patterns overlapping, and when that interacts with the particular structure of your optics, you then see a third pattern emerging, and that actually that he saw that process as a metaphorical description of a particular kind of a particular thing that's happening in living systems. Actually, this is the nature of the recursion within living systems. And he had an exercise for trying to think through self-empathy within a system or between systems, which was an exercise that he used to set students. Maybe this is actually a good thing to end on, just as a kind of a formal exercise for architecture students in their head, which basically he would have a series of, he'd have a class, it was quite weird classes that he was running at Kresge College in the 70s, weren't really in any discipline in particular, but and basically he'd arrive with, the story goes, with a box of shells of various kinds, of crabs and lobsters and conch shells and various things. And would basically ask students to come up with arguments that would suggest why these are the remains of living things, and which I think is in general a a kind of sort of fascinating challenge. But the answer, I mean, there isn't a straight answer, but the answer is in a way about recognizing patterns of correspondence and difference between the different kinds of the different kinds of structures, and that recognizing of nested patterns and difference is partly this abduction thing, and he might have actually even used the term self-empathy within, that's. Yeah.